to have multiple voices here, like yourself, Professor. Thank you. Thank you for being with us. And then I hope you all enjoy the lectures and make most of it. Now, please relax and have your faculties ready. Just a final notice, please keep yourself away from the keyboard, I mean the settings, if you don't mind. Now I'm passing the word to Professor Şekerci to introduce our guest speaker. Thank you.
Okay, then. Stephen, actually, if you don't mind, I'd like to introduce you briefly to the audience, even though you are world-renowned scholar, but some Frenchmen among the audience, they might not know you and your works. So actually, ladies and gentlemen, Stephen Greenblatt got his PhD from Yale. He is Cogan University Professor of the Humanities at Harvard University, also General Editor of the Norton Anthology of English Literature. He is the author of 11 books, including Tyrant, The Rise and Fall of Adam and Eve, The Story That Created Us, The Swerve, How the World Became Modern, winner of the 2011 National Book Award, and then 2012 Pulitzer Prize, Shakespeare's Freedom, Within the World, How Shakespeare Became Shakespeare, Hamlet in Purgatory, Marvelous Possessions, The Wonder of the New World, Learning to Curse, Essays in Early Modern Culture, and Renaissance Self-Fashioning, From More to Shakespeare. He has edited 7 collections of criticism, including Cultural Mobility, a manifesto, and is a founding co-editor of the journal Representations. His honors include the MLA's James Russell Lowell Prize for both Shakespearean negotiations, the circulation of social energy in Renaissance England, and the Swerve and the Sapegno Prize, the Distinguished Humanist Award from the Mellon Foundation, the Wilbur Cross Medal from the Yale University Graduate School, the William Shakespeare Award for Classical Theater, the Erasmus Institute Prize, 2 Guggenheim Fellowships, and the Distinguished Teaching Award from the University of California, Berkeley. He was president of the Modern Language Association of America and is a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the American Philosophical Society, and the American Academy of Arts and Letters. Ladies and gentlemen, actually, for further information, please see a magnificent article about Professor Greenblatt in Encyclopedia Britannica, written by Richard Pilardi, one of the editors of the Encyclopedia Britannica. So if you don't mind, Professor and dear guests, actually, I would like to share a couple of or some editorial reviews of Greenblatt's latest book, A Tyrant, Shakespeare on Politics, published in 2018 by Norton Company, New York, and okay then, sorry, I think that was internet cut off. Actually, Tyrant, the latest book of Professor Tyrant, Shakespeare on Politics, published in 2018 by Norton Company, New York and London. Actually, I have got that book already and I have read it. I do strongly recommend it to all Shakespeare and literature lovers. Really, it's a magnificent, inspiring book. So please, if you don't mind, I'd like to share a couple of reviews. So Greenblatt is especially fine on the mechanisms of tyranny, its ecology, so to speak, leaving one deeply moved all over again by Shakespeare's profound and direct understanding of what it is to be human, which includes, alas, being a tyrant. Simon Callow, New York Times book review. Rarely have these blood-soaked creatures seemed so recognizably human and so contemporary. John Lithgow, elegant and deftly written. Eliot A. Cohen, Washington Post. So Greenblatt shows us not only Shakespeare's writings can serve as a brilliant guide to the mess of our current politics, but also that he, Greenblatt, that is perfectly well able to give us an account of them. Los Angeles Review of Books. So let me share another one by Guardian, by the way. Look, an engaging study of some of the most eloquent despots on stage, Guardian. So last one, if you don't mind, from Wall Street Journal, Mr. Greenblatt breaks with the traditional assumption that Shakespeare must have been an uncritical admirer of monarchy. The Shakespeare that this book reveals is not only able to tell a bad king from a good, but willing to raise serious doubts about monarchy as a regime. Thank you very much. Yes, Stephen, the floor yours. Please be honest with you. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. And I'm honored and delighted to be here. And I'm very grateful to you all for joining and watching. And I'm looking forward to the possibility of having a conversation. If you have questions, I'll say a little bit about my book, but then I will leave time for questions. Mm-hmm. I want to say first, before I begin, that it's particularly gratifying to me to have this conversation with you, because Turkey occupies a very important place for me in my life. And not only because it's a wonderful country and I visited many times and I love the country very much, but because at the beginning of my career, or actually before the beginning of my career, I was a student in England at Cambridge University, and on a long vacation that Cambridge is organized, the university, so you have long vacations. The first vacation that I went to, didn't have very much money, but I thought I would go as far as I could possibly go on whatever I had, and I went to Istanbul in 1965, in the spring of 1965. And I was at that point in my life a student and was not certain whether I thought I would go to law school and become a lawyer. And I had received an acceptance to law school. And I had my friends in Cambridge forward my mail to me in Istanbul. In those days, without email, that's how you did it. So when I was there in Istanbul and very excited, I had never seen a city so magical and extraordinary as Istanbul. I mean, I was 20 years old, 21 years old. And completely overwhelmed by Istanbul, I received two letters. One was a letter that would let me stay in England for another year, and if I did that, I knew I was going to go to graduate school and become an English professor, continue to work on Shakespeare. And the other was the letter from law school, saying that I could come back to, I could go to law school the next year. And I took the two letters and I walked down from the American Express office, wherever it was, up on the hill to the Galata Bridge. And I stood on the Galata Bridge. In those days, I think it's been rebuilt then. In those days, there were many cafes and restaurants on the pontoons across the bridge. And I stood and I held the two letters in my hand and I looked out at Istanbul, at the minarets and domes, and I tore up the letter from law school and I threw it in the water. And I decided to go to, I can't explain even why, but something about Istanbul, something about being there at that moment made me think I wanted to spend my life studying art, literature, Shakespeare, and then that the rest is just my life, my career. I didn't go to law school, but anyway, I owe my career, such as this, the shape of my career to Turkey and to my being in Istanbul in 1965.
Great to hear, Professor. Great to hear. Thank you.
So that's my beginning. So Shakespeare brooded throughout his career on a particular question, a problem. How does a complex, apparently healthy society with the ordinary motives of human beings for self-protection and self-interest, how does such a society fall into the hands of a catastrophic leader? How does it happen that someone who is manifestly bad for a country becomes its leader. Tyrants, in not only Shakespeare's account, but the account of his own time, of others, are those who govern not for their country, but for themselves, who take account not of the public interest, but of their own interest and pleasure. That was the distinction that Shakespeare in his age made between legitimate rule and illegitimate rule, tyrannical rule. So how does it happen, Shakespeare asked himself, that a country could fall into the hands of such a leader? And he returned to this problem again and again in his life, in his histories and his tragedies, and even in some of the late comedies. He thought about this question. How do cherished institutions, institutions that seem secure, how do they become fragile? Why do large numbers of people, he asked, accept being lied to? Why does it happen that large numbers of people in a country will be lied willing? What gives rise to this? Shakespeare didn't think that there was a single route that led to the disaster of a catastrophic leader. He tried out many different scenarios in his plays, including, for example, the rise of tyranny by assassination. That's what happens in Macbeth. Or the folly of a leader who's been flattered for so long that he thinks he should always get his way, even if he's doing something foolish. That's the situation at the beginning of King Lear. Or a sudden inexplicable descent into madness as a route toward tragedy. And that's what Shakespeare depicts in The Winter's Tale, his late comedy. But for me, at least, the most detailed scenario comes in the succession of early history plays, about plays that were written about the Wars of the Roses, the 15th century wars, about a century and a half before Shakespeare wrote these plays. Wars that, in Shakespeare's view, determined the shape of his England as he knew it. And those plays are not very often read or performed, but they're quite interesting. They're plays called the Henry VI plays. They had slightly different names at the time. Henry VI, Part 1, 2, and 3, we call them now. And then a further play, Richard III, which is a play that many people still read and perform. And so here's the vision that Shakespeare very roughly described. Here's the vision that Shakespeare gives in these early history plays. First of all, there's a well-meaning but weak regime, a weak leader. And that weakness of the leader allows factions to begin to be formed in the country. And the factions become increasingly bitter and factionalized, increasingly incapable of cooperating, compromising, communicating with one another. And then there comes a significant number of people in the country who feel that they're not actually represented by the existing system of government, who feel that their interests, that their concerns, that their identity is not adequately represented by whoever is ruling the country. So that large number of people who do not feel represented, Shakespeare thought that's a serious problem in the rise of a tyrannical rule. Because what will happen in that situation, Shakespeare thought, was that someone would come along who would claim to speak for those people who are not represented by the existing regime. And that's what Shakespeare depicts in Henry the second part of this trilogy, Henry the Sixth, Part Two, when there's a demagogic leader, a loudmouth, intolerant, nationalistic leader. Shakespeare takes a figure from history called John Cade, Jack Cade, and depicts that character, who speaks to the crowd and represents himself as their spokesperson. So I'll give you a little taste from my book. Jack Cade leads a mob in Shakespeare's depiction who gather just outside of London. And this character, this demagogue, Jack Cade, starts to make wild and extravagant promises, including economic promises that he couldn't possibly keep. He says, there shall be in England 7 halfpenny loaves of bread sold for a penny. And the 3-hoop pot shall have 10 hoops. In other words, you can get much more now. You can get the equivalent of 7 loaves of bread for a single penny that you'd pay for a single loaf. Or you'll get much more beer when you order beer. Everything, and you can drink, he says, on my score. I'll pay for everyone's drinks. The campaign promises, because that's what they are ridiculous. And yet the fact that they're ridiculous and that anyone rational could see that they're ridiculous doesn't seem to be an impediment. On the contrary, this character keeps producing falsehoods, lies about his origins, making wild claims for the things he can do. He'll make England great again. And the crowds eagerly swallow them. And his neighbors, who are also in the crowd, know that he's a liar. They're perfectly aware that he's a liar. And yet, that is, for Shakespeare, the disturbing and fascinating problem. The fact that they know he's a liar doesn't invalidate his claims, doesn't weaken his power upon them. He draws on his own indifference to truth, on shamelessness, on a hyperinflated self-confidence, and he enters a kind of fantasy land. When I am king, as king I will be, he says, and he invites the listeners to enter the same magical space with him. In that space, 2 and 2 don't equal 4, and the most recent claim doesn't have to remember the claim he's made 2 minutes before. So in ordinary times, when a leader is caught making lies, his standing is diminished. But in times that are not ordinary, the times that Shakespeare thought allowed the rise of tyranny, if a bystander were to point out that the demagogue is lying, the crowd would turn and attack the critic, not the demagogue. And at the climax of one of Cade's speeches, it's the only line that people remember from this play, Henry VI, Part 2. The first thing we do, let's kill all the lawyers, one of his followers shouts. Okay, that's the core of the rise in Shakespeare of this kind of demagogue, who combines nationalist fervor. We'll make England great again. We'll defeat the French. We'll be the most powerful country once again, and so forth and so on. Nationalist fervor with militarism. We'll go to war with a kind of voodoo economics, fraudulent economics. I'll give you something for nothing. An attack on the law. Let's kill all the lawyers. And also, Shakespeare thought, very much part of this rise, an attack on the education system. Shakespeare thought that the rise of tyranny depended on an attack on on education itself. And what he depicts is, in a grotesque scene, is the mob catching someone and saying, yes, this is a person who created a school where they teach nouns and verbs and foreign languages. He must be an enemy. And it's out of that situation, Shakespeare thought, that a tyranny could arise. Not because this loudmouthed demagogue, in Shakespeare's account, would become the ruler, but because he was a kind of pawn for someone else in the wings. And that person will eventually Now, am I unmuted? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes, right. Professor, now yes.
Okay. Could you hear me before?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, we did. We did.
Just suddenly muted. So what Shakespeare depicts in Richard III is in some ways the most interesting and the most disturbing aspect of Shakespeare's thinking about the rise of tyranny. He thought the ultimate rise of tyranny would be through an election, something that would look like a free election. That's unusual and even strange because, after all, Shakespeare lived in a monarchy, so not in an electoral system. And yet Shakespeare thought that the likeliest way in which a tyrant would achieve the highest power in the land would be by being elected by the people. And that's what he depicts in Richard III. And then he asked himself, how would that happen? And he thought it would take not simply one very strong-willed person, but it would take people that I would call enablers, people who would enable him to rise to power. And Shakespeare gave those enablers names, the names of different characters. He depicts them in his plays. There are those who are genuinely fooled by the tyrant, but Shakespeare thought that those weren't very many. They were children, they were extremely naive and powerless people, and they were genuinely fooled by the lies. But there were others. There were those who were frightened and impotent in the face of the threats and the bullying. There were those who, if you yell at them, if you threaten them, will just shrink away, will not resist. There are those who have difficulty keeping in focus that the leader is really as bad as he seems. They keep telling themselves, well, it's not so bad, as if it were hard work to remember. That is to say, Shakespeare thought that there was a strong urge to normalize what is not normal when the legal system of a country begins to collapse. And there are those who don't forget that the leader is as bad, but they trust that everything will right itself, that the norms will hold. People who, in other words, rely on a structure that they think is stronger than it is. The structure can prove unexpectedly fragile. And then there are those who think that they can take advantage of the tyrant's rise to power, that they'll be able to stay one step ahead of the tide of evil, and they'll be able to profit from it. And then there are those who enjoy the cruel game, who make love to the employment, as Shakespeare says in Hamlet, who enjoy harming other people. Shakespeare didn't think there were a lot of those, but he thought there were always some like that who would come out in situations like this and help the tyrant. Now, I'm going to stop in a minute, but I want to raise two other issues about these enablers. One is, where are the women? Because the figures that I've just mentioned are, by and large, almost entirely male. And Shakespeare thought in general that this whole system was a largely male system. In fact, he thought, in the case of Macbeth, that it depended on certain kind of male anxieties, even. We can talk about that later. But in the case of Richard III, Shakespeare depicts a woman, name is Lady Anne, and he very carefully makes it ambiguous as to whether she is being forced, in effect raped, or being seduced. And it's as if Shakespeare himself thought that it was a fine line for women in this situation, a difficult thing for women to resist. Lady Anne at first spits, strikes, hates Richard, and at the same time seems to be seduced by him. So that's an ambiguous situation, Shakespeare thought. The women in a situation of this kind, in an authoritarian rule, on the one hand are the core of a certain kind of resistance. On the other hand, they can be drawn in to the system. They can be some of the most ardent supporters of the tyrant. And then Shakespeare also thought that something about, probably something about the way in which the tyrant was treated as a child would help produce the personality type that would lead to this kind of person. And he depicts this at several different moments in his career. The last thing I want to say, and it has to do with the question of seduction, is that it wasn't, it's not simply women who are seduced by the tyrant, it's everyone. And Shakespeare's thinking about that depended upon his brooding about what it meant to be a member of the audience. Shakespeare was one of the greatest rhetoricians, one of the greatest the greatest experts on mass psychology who's ever lived. That's what plays do. You take 2,000 or 3,000 people into a room and you shape their perceptions. He knew that there was something about his art that was very powerful and very much bound up with the possibility of tyranny. And one of the things he thought about in his whole career was how mass media, his own medium, the theater, could participate either in the rise of a tyrant or in awakening the populace to the threat of tyranny. And what I hope I explore in my book, and what I would love to talk to you further today, if we have time for some questions and comments, would be the ways in which the theater can actually enable tyranny and resist tyranny. But I'm going to stop here and ask if you have questions. I don't see a chat function on my screen, but there may be one that you've been receiving.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. Actually, I mean, if you don't mind, I have some sort of discussion questions which might appeal to the audience as well. Well, you know, the debate about the authorship of Shakespeare's plays has been going on for hundreds of years, right? So, unfortunately, up to now, I mean, the problem or the issue or the debate has not been resolved yet. So, pertinent to this issue or concerning to this issue, I read an article on the 5th of April 2020 in the Observer of British newspaper. The article written by Dahlia Aldrich, the article is titled as Shakespeare's secret co-writer finally takes a bow 430 years late. Well, the article deals with Professor Gary Taylor's new research. Probably you already know him, who is a Shakespeare scholar at Florida State University. In his new research, Professor Taylor claims that Thomas Watson, recognized by literary scholars as the Bard's forgotten 16th century collaborator. Watson was greatly admired at the time, celebrated for tragic plays before Marlowe and Shakespeare became famous. Well, what do you think about it then, if you don't mind?
About the claim that Thomas Watson wrote the plays?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, first of all, Thomas Watson had the misfortune of dying quite a lot before, a long, long time before, not a long time before Shakespeare lived. He lived at the same time. Watson was born in about 1653. Shakespeare was born in 64, so he was older than Shakespeare, but he died young. Mm-hmm. And so that he would have had to leave about 2/3 of Shakespeare's plays hidden in a drawer somewhere, which is extremely unlikely. Secondly, what survives of Watson most famously is a collection of poems, an interesting collection of poems called the Hecatompathia. And they bear absolutely no resemblance to anything that, in my view, anything that Shakespeare wrote. Watson was a very learned man, really genuinely learned. He translated Sophocles' Antigone from Greek into Latin and so forth and so on. He's a very interesting man, but he doesn't seem to me a very strong candidate for authorship of Shakespeare's plays.
Okay, thank you. Well, I mean, look, Charlie Chaplin once said, quote, very interesting, life is a tragedy when seen in close-up, but a comedy in long shot. Do the gods or God or and his angels look down on our doings in close-up or long shot in Shakespeare's works?
That's a very interesting question. And Shakespeare, on the whole, I would say in the history plays and tragedy plays, the tragedies doesn't think that the rise of tyranny and the civil wars of a country are very funny. He generally thinks that they're extremely melancholy events, sad events. Nonetheless, of course, you're right that there is something grotesquely funny about Richard III, for example. Much of Richard III is done in the as if it were a kind of crazy comedy, and it's only really as the play builds up its momentum that you realize how much people are suffering. Little children are being killed. The women are dying. The country is falling apart. But it looks like, for a while, like it's a comedy. I imagine that that is true in many countries, that the initial impulses in the rise of a tyrant are actually kind of the release of a certain kind of comic energy. But the price that's paid is way too high. And Shakespeare thought the price was very, very high.
Well, thank you. I mean, sorry, last one. You know, some left-wing scholars such as Terry Eagleton and Raymond Williams claim that, quote, for the last 100 years that the establishment has hijacked tragedy and turned it into a lucky of the status quo. I just really wonder, what do you think about it? Or what could you say? What would you like to say?
I think that it is the case that tragedy, perhaps in general, but Shakespeare in particular, one of the things that's interesting about Shakespeare, about the reception of Shakespeare, is that it goes in multiple directions. Shakespeare has been the hero of quite conservative figures. He's been the hero of radical left-wing figures. Mm-hmm. He's been the hero of bourgeois liberal figures. So there's a way in which Shakespeare allows himself to be championed by people who actually have no interests in common. In fact, who would in fact kill each other if allowed the chance. And that's an interesting phenomenon. The question is why. And my sense is that, first of all, that Shakespeare wrote very deliberately to allow multiple interpretations, to allow the plays to be taken in very different directions. It doesn't mean that the plays are neutral, but it means that the plays allow multiple possibilities. There are different roads you can take. You can't take them at the same time, but that you can go out of them in different ways. And I think Shakespeare knew that. I think he did this deliberately. If you want to say as a left winger that the reactionaries have captured Shakespeare and kidnapped him, you could also say that the leftists have kidnapped Shakespeare. That is to say, and the language of kidnapping is a mistake, because the point is that the plays allow themselves to be used in multiple ways, in multiple directions.
Okay, thank you so much. Dr. Shentürk, could you please kindly have questions from the audience for Professor Greenblatt? Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Okay, thank you, Professor. And it has been a fascinating lecture. Thank you. And I have just one question before I can take our students' question. So it has been a fascinating talk. It has contributed to my understanding of the rise of tyrants and the role of drama and their resistance to the rise of tyrants. And I have a quick question for you. Who do you think creates the tyrant? Is he God-made, human-made, or self-made? Or this is my question.
I think Shakespeare thought that I don't think Shakespeare thought the tyrant was God-made. I think, although it's true that there is talk about the tyrant as God's punishment, but it's punishment for a society that's gone in the wrong direction. I think on the whole, Shakespeare thought that tyrants are made by societies. Tyrants are made by groups of people, not self-made, because after all, the tyrant is just one person. And yep. You could ignore him. You could laugh at him. So if you ask yourself, how is it possible that someone like this comes to power? You have to look to a whole society and to multiple forces that make it possible. So at least I think that's what Shakespeare thought. He also thought, as I mentioned very briefly, I think he thought psychologically that something about the way in which such a person was raised created the personality, the indifference to the truth, the narcissism, selfishness, the vulgarity that led to that kind of person emerging. But I think he thought in that sense that, something about the childhood, you can see in Coriolanus, you can see in Richard III, Shakespeare thinking about how does such a person come to exist? What happens when such a person is a child that leads him to that kind of personality? So in that sense, he looks in the family as well as in the society.
Okay, thank you. That's quite clear. So have you ever thought female tyrant, the idea of female tyrant?
Well, Shakespeare didn't. I mean, or at least I don't think he did. Of course, there were people in Shakespeare's time who said that Queen Elizabeth was a tyrant. And there are other figures of authoritarian female rulers certainly historically, there are many. Maybe not so many, but there are some. But I don't think Shakespeare thought that was likely to be the source of the problem, partly because I think Shakespeare thought that a certain kind of authoritarianism had to do with male sexual anxiety.
Yeah, exactly.
That you see Macbeth, Lady Macbeth, tantalizing, teasing Macbeth. Oh, if you were a man, you would do this. That kind of anxiety about being a man was characteristic, Shakespeare thought, of the kind of person who emerged as a tyrant.
Okay, that makes great sense. Thank you, Professor. So now for the audience, if you have any questions for the professor, could you please raise your hands so that I can see, and then I can give the word to you.
I see some hands up on my screen.
Please try to pronounce the names.
Well, you want to laugh at me.
No, never.
So the names that I see.
Mustafa Şahin Erdi, hocam. Mustafa Şahin Erdi, sorry.
Ayşegül Yönür.
Mm-hmm.
I see that. Okay. I see Kerem Topçu.
Right.
Correctly.
Right.
Mustafa Şahinier.
Şahinier, right.
So we have 170 participants, so it's really difficult. So to support the hands, so Mustafa Şahinier, yep, please have your question ready for the professor. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, this is Mustafa Şahinier. That's the exact pronunciation, Stephen.
How do you
do? Fine. Thank you. Thank you very much. How about yourself?
Very well.
Thank you for the great talk. I am one of the candidates who is trying to be a Shakespeare scholar as well. Actually, my both MA and PhDs were on Shakespeare's history plays. And I'd like to I wrote about Jack Cade Rebellion as well in one of the chapters in my PhD thesis. I was just wondering, how would you compare Greene's Salamis and Richard III, you know, as tyrants who are both diabolic, actually, as we know. And what I'm especially wondering is that we know how the Elizabethan audience would receive Richard III on their stage, you know. They would identify themselves, or the issues, the contemporary issues would be identified through Richard III. That's understandable. But what I'm wondering is that whether they would still be, drawing analogies from Selimus, or were the audience simply thinking that, well, it's a foreign land, that's the bloody Turks, the cruel Turks, whatever is happening there, so it's none of our concern. They were just, watching the play for the sake of watching it. Was it of any use to the society, the English society of that day, Selimus, the Turkish emperor?
Yes. Yeah. I think that's a very interesting question, Mustafa. I think that the English audience of the time would have always understood that the representation of an other, an outsider, whether a Muslim, a Jew, a black man, as in Othello, was also a representation of England, of themselves. In other words, I don't think they would simply have gone. They would also have gone for the entertainment of seeing how things were done in faraway places, such as in the Ottoman Empire. But I think they always took these stories back to themselves, so that the representation of Selimus, for example, in Green, is not only a representation of the Turks, but a representation also of the English. And it also worked in two different directions, as your question suggests. On the one hand, the English had a kind of fairy tale negative version of the Turks. You have also Henry the Hal, Prince Hal, telling his brothers, "I'm not. Don't have to worry. I'm not going to kill you. I'm not a Turk. I'm not Turkish," and so forth. I mean, at the other hand, the English admired, as you probably know, the English Europeans in general were frightened of the Turkish Empire, not because they were only thought them as wicked, but they thought them as incredibly impressive. They thought them as they were, as extremely competent, as well organized, as disciplined, as morally serious, and so forth. So it wasn't simply that they had a kind of negative account of the Turks. And even in Green Selimus, you have slightly, I don't know if you would agree, but you have, I think, slightly ambiguous representations of the
Very much so. Indeed. Thank you. I did make use of your books as well in my researches, and thank you for that.
I'm grateful. Thank you very much.
Very, very happy to have met you here too. I've actually written a manuscript as well for my associate professorship, and the title goes From Grand Turk to Cruel Turk, the representation of the Turk in early modern English drama. English.
Perfect. That's exactly the kind of thing. Yes, exactly what I'm suggesting. So wonderful. That's wonderful. And I hope, inshallah, we'll meet someday.
Inshallah. Stephen, the way I see things is that, you know, starting with the first encounters or first interactions, both culturally, physically came later, though. The Turk was the Grand Turk, as you were just mentioning. You know, they were respecting the Turks. They were there. They were a threat, but yet a distant threat at the beginning of the first encounters. As the time went on, you know, the treatment of the characters on stages, as well as the Turkish characters in the street ballads, as well as the mentioning of the Turks in the Elizabethan sermons and homilies, for example, they start from a standpoint where they would look at the Turks as a respected, still other, but a respected other. Yeah. And as time went on, especially after the Battle of Lepanto, and when they were aware that Turks were also able to lose, you know, in war, the calling names starts at that moment, actually. You know, the mentioning is usually Grand Turk, the Courageous Turk, and all that stuff. But later on, it changes into Cruel Turk, you know, Heathen. The Heathen was already there, always there. But all sorts of pejorative words started to be used for the Turks. That's an interesting line to follow as well, actually.
It is interesting. Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome. I thank you.
Okay, thanks for this fascinating question. And do we have any other questions, guys, by the way?
Ayşegül, Ernur, yes. Please. Ernur, Ayşegül Ernur, right?
Yes. Hello, Professor. I mean, it's great to see you here, and your works nourished my understanding of Shakespeare a lot, and especially Basically, your way of describing "My Mouth Shall Be the Parliament of England" speech in your latest work inspired the title of my thesis. So thank you very much.
Well, I'm very pleased. I'm honored. Thank you.
I just wanted to have a little question, as we mentioned male dominance in the world of tyrants. And in your latest work, Tyrants, you don't give much space on Richard II's role as an maybe aspiring tyrant. Where do we put Richard II's place in this, world of tyrants?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question, Ashigul. I wasn't sure what to do with Richard II, truthfully. In this book, I thought it was pulling me in the wrong direction. In part, I confess to you, maybe I shouldn't say, because I had a particular political agenda in this book, that I was interested in speaking to my own politics, the politics of the United States over the last 4 years, and I couldn't figure out what to say about Richard II. I think the question is an interesting one, independent of that, my own problem, for two reasons. Because Richard, at the beginning of the play, Richard II, behaves in a autocratic way, not listening to anyone, simply doing what he wants, exiling, bringing back, taking people's money as he takes Bolingbroke's money. So he looks like a kind of figure of precisely of the tyrant, but then he falls apart. And by the end of the play, actually, his enemy, Bolingbroke, who's taken over, is not exactly a tyrant, but is tinged with some of the same autocratic, quietly ordering the murder of Richard, executing people without warrant. So the play, as if the play teeters back and forth between two different accounts. And I simply wasn't sure how to get it in focus adequately, but maybe you do. I mean, it's a wonderful play, a remarkable play, but I couldn't fit it into my account. And so I just left it out.
I mean, it's my favorite play. So I wanted to ask, when I was reading your book, it was a point of mystery for me.
It's a fabulous play, I agree. So I welcome your writing about it, and I'm sure you will do it better than I would do it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. Stephen, I'm sorry. Do we have some time for people waiting in line to ask their questions? For example, Kerem Burhan Topçu, please.
Thank you. Professor, thank you for this chance of meeting. My question, I'm an MA student at Yeditepe University. But I am only an MA student, so my question has a simple nature, actually. You have talked about combining nationalistic fervor with militarism, fraudulent economics, attacks on law and education. And you have also said that a tyrant can come to highest power by election, giving an example from Richard III. So, my question is, in an age when tyrants are rising again throughout the world, and even after the fact that after World War II, we have said never again about those kinds of politics, in an age when tyrants are rising again in the world, is it only Shakespeare's visionary genius that foresaw this conundrum about human nature, or are we this incapable of change and learning from history, learning from art, learning from literature?
I wish I could answer that question adequately, Kerem. It is absolutely true of me that I wrote the book, this book, as I did, because looking around in the world, there seemed to have been the rise of authoritarianism again, of a kind that we thought that we were free of, at least imagined that we might be free of, after, as you say, after World War II. I would have said that we have as a, I don't have an adequate answer to your question, except to say that I think we are vulnerable as collective, as societies, to this kind of power. I went, in the course of writing my book on the story of Adam and Eve, this will seem like a strange connection, but I went to Western Uganda in Africa to observe chimpanzees, because a friend of mine, a scientist at Harvard, has a chimpanzee research station there. And what you see, if you observe chimpanzees close up, is the power of the super leader of the chimpanzee, the alpha male, who beats up the other males, who attacks the females, tries to keep them all for himself. And though I don't think we're chimpanzees, Karim, I think we have in us, collectively, the possibility of succumbing to that kind of bullying leader. So, and I think that Shakespeare also understood that. So it doesn't go away by virtue of reading a play or even by enduring what the world endured under Hitler, let's say, or Stalin. But I'm also interested in a different aspect of the problem that you describe. And I'll put it this way. It is one person's tyrant is another person's heroic leader. What I perceive as a tyrant, someone else perceives as a savior, built into our political life as well. In countries like yours, Turkey, or mine, the United States, that are quite in, divided, one side sees things in a very different way than the other side sees things. And in the election that just took place in the United States, I felt myself that I had a kind of crisis of imagination. I found it difficult to imagine my way into the mind of the of almost half the country that was voting the other way than I want, was voting. And that's not always the case. I used to be able to imagine that, but I felt suddenly I couldn't imagine. Why did these people want that? Why do they want, but they thought the same thing about me. And what I, and that situation in which it's difficult for one side of a country to imagine what the other side wants, it's difficult to enter into that mind, is a problem that the theater can address, that Shakespeare is able to address. He doesn't solve the problem, but he's able, he's, he enables you to get into the minds of people who don't, who are the opposite of what you want, who are the enemy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kerem. Actually, Miss Karaman, please. Do we have time? Stephen, please.
Yes, I have time for one more question and then I must go.
All right, then. Thank you. Sorry. I know you have time limit. Thank you so much. Yes, Karaman, Miss Karaman, please.
Hello. I'm a lecturer at Yeditepe University. And it's an honor to be listening to you now. We are very lucky. Therefore, I want to thank the organizers, our colleagues in Süleyman Demirel University and Kafkas University. So I will directly go into the question which has been bothering me in a way since I have read your latest work, which was fascinating, by the way. Would it be possible for us to draw a line, or would you diagnose a sort of difference between the tyrannies of Coriolanus and that of Richard III or Macbeth in the sense that Coriolanus's ambition always seems to be the ambition for heroism in the battlefield rather than ruling a nation. Thank you.
Yes, Carmen, that's a wonderful question, and I do think you could draw a serious distinction between the two of them. I mean, both Coriolanus and Richard III have certain kind of male qualities together. I mean, Shakespeare identifies as certain masculine qualities, and they also have a kind of narcissistic self-absorption, both of them, but nonetheless, they're quite different. And not only the difference that you point to, where Coriolanus has been, in effect, trained by his mother to seek military victories at all costs, to cover himself with scars and so forth and so on, but also Coriolanus is a kind of ideologue in a way that Richard III isn't. That is to say, Coriolanus, as he's depicted later in the play, when he's tries to run for consul, he believes in the rule of the upper class, the rule of the nobles, and despises the peasants, the ordinary people whom he thinks are worthless and shouldn't have any political power at all. That's an ideological position. Richard III, that's not Richard III. He doesn't behave that way. So I think there is a profound difference between the two of them. Thank you for the question.
Thank you.
Look, I want to thank all of you, and I want to thank the organizers and the university for having me. It's a real honor for me. I started by saying I have a love for Turkey, continue to have it, and now you've made me feel all the more so at having this conversation. So thank you.
Stephen, thank you so much for honoring us. I wish you a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. I hope we will host you in Turkey soon after COVID-19.
I hope so. That would be wonderful. I would love to come back.
Sorry we have no time, Professor. Has no time. So sorry. Thank you very much. Once again, Stephen, take care. Bye for now.
Happy New
thank
Year.
You. Thank you, Professor.
Bye bye. Arkadaşlar, okay, thank you. Arkadaşlar, herkese iyi akşamlar diliyoruz.
Ömer Hocam, ben
teşekkür ediyorum.
Almış olarak bir şey söylemek istiyorum. Ellerinize sağlık, çok teşekkürler. Çok güzel bir hizmet yapıyorsunuz akademik dünyamda. Ben de onu zaman bulamadım ama elleriniz dert görmesin. Çok güzel işler yaptınız. Çok çok sağ olun. Ben
eksik olmayın. Sağ olun arkadaşlar. Herkese çok teşekkür ediyorum.
Teşekkürler.
Kusura bakmayın, sorular alamadık ama şöyleydi bizim anlaşmamız. Hocayla aslında 30 dakika biz anlaşmıştık. Biraz böyle interaction şeklinde olacaktı. O yüzden ben bunu yani bir diyalog olarak algılamayın. Çünkü öyleydi. Hatta ben biraz daha sizlere söz hakkı vereyim diye sorularımı azalttım. Yoksa bizim normalde yarım saatlik interaction şeklinde geçmesi gerekiyordu. Ki öyleydi anlaşmamız ama katılımcı çok olduğu için mutlaka katılımcılardan soru soracak dostlarımız olacağını düşündüğüm için inanın kısa kestim. Herkese çok teşekkür ediyorum. İnşallah bundan sonra da yine böyle etkinliklerde sizleri bekliyoruz.
Sayın Hocam, ben de yine Erasmus Üniversitesi adına hepinize çok teşekkür ediyorum. Akdeniz'den, Yeditepe'den bizleri yalnız bırakmadınız. Biz buralardayız, Kars'ta. Buralara da yolunuz düşerse bekleriz.
Her zaman. Dostlar, herkese iyi akşamlar diliyorum. Sevgiyle kalın.
Ömer Hocam saygılar, iyi akşamlar.
İyi akşamlar efendim, buyursunlar.
Doğan Ordu Üniversitesi'nden dinleyici olarak katıldım.
Sağ olun, teşekkür ederim.
Dinlediğiniz için sizlere ve Selçuk Şentürk hocama çok teşekkür ediyorum. Hani Kafkas Üniversitesi'nde de çalıştığım için oralarda da bütün etkinliklerin ortaya çıkması bizi mutlu ediyor. Emeğiniz çok, eksik olmayın, teşekkür ederim.
Teşekkür ederiz efendim, sağ olun. Sizler de eksik olmayınız. Teşekkür ederim. Dostlar, herkese iyi akşamlar diliyorum. Görüşmek üzere. Sağ olun. Sevgiyle kalınız. Sağ olun.